I think the cross-border estate planning is something that a lot of expats don't necessarily pay attention to, and it's something that's really important. Because in the U.S., the tax is paid by the person's estate of the deceased. So it's paid by the deceased's estate. So for example, if I died, it's not the people who receive the inheritance that pay the tax. It's my estate pays the tax on my assets, and whatever's left would then go to the heirs. Okay? Most European countries tax the recipients, the people who receive it. So talking about Germany, for example, I know Germany taxes the recipients. So you wind up with a situation where the US is taxing basically the person who died, and then Germany is taxing the people that are getting the inheritance. And so that's something where you really have to take a look at how you're gonna do that planning. And especially when you start looking at what happens if you have it's one thing if you have everything in Germany, right? Then you do have some ability, and Germany is one of the countries that has an estate gift tax treaty with the United States that gives some relief on how to calculate it. But where do you do your wills, right? Because Germany won't always necessarily recognize a U.S. will. The U.S. might not recognize a German will. In some states in the U.S., for example, if you have assets, no matter what your will says, like if you say, I'm not giving my wife anything, I'm giving everything to my kids, some states won't even allow that. And they'll say, no, the wife's entitled to half, and they'll invalidate the will. Well, what happens if in Germany then? So it gets very, very complex. Yes?
Keep going.
Okay.
I have a question.
Okay. And then, you have other issues. Like, for example, I live most of the time in Dubai, where you have, for anybody who's in the Middle East, for the most part, they don't recognize wills. And so if you die, your assets are going to get passed according to Sharia law. So you have to do special planning there, for that. And then another one of the things is in the U.S., and this is something that we see quite often, you have, let's say, one spouse who's a U.S. citizen and another spouse who's not, and they own a vacation home in the U.S. And the U.S. citizen spouse dies, and it goes to the non-resident. The non-resident doesn't have any U.S. gift tax exclusion. So if they wanted to give that house to their kids, they'd pay 40% tax on the value of the house. So it's not just planning, estate planning for expats needs to be like a living, breathing thing. Because every time you acquire an asset in any country, you need to think about this.
Uh-huh.
It's something that's very, very important.
So I have a kind of specific question. My husband's German, but we live here in Switzerland, and my kids have German, American, and now we all have Swiss citizenship. My husband has three pieces of property in Germany.
Yeah.
So that my kids will inherit.
Yeah.
But they live in Switzerland. They'll have to pay German inheritance tax on that German property. Will they have to pay Swiss and American inheritance tax?
I forgot. Did you say your husband has American citizenship?
No.
Okay.
He has German and Swiss.
So,
I have American.
So they will not have to pay any U.S. So U.S. citizens can inherit an unlimited amount of money from non-U.S. citizens tax-free.
Okay. So they're better off inheriting stuff from my husband than from me.
Yes. Well, I mean, look, from the U.S. side, you also have to look at it from the standpoint of, you have 11.2 million that you can pass on for free.
Okay.
So unless what you have is worth more than 11.2 million,
okay,
you don't really need to worry about that.
Okay.
What's more important is looking at the countries. One of the things, and this is just an example. So somebody, and I mean, probably your husband's owned these for a long time if he's from Germany and stuff. But, a lot of times what happens is people, and this is one of the things that always amazes me with real estate. If somebody wants to go start a business in another country, The first thing they do is they go talk to a lawyer, they talk to a tax person, like, how do I set this up in your country? I'm not familiar with it. But real estate's one of those things where people just dive in. Like, I see it all the time. Like, people go to a country, they hire a real estate agent, they go buy a property. And so, and I'll give you an example. So let's say, you know, you have a house in Germany that is owned personally by somebody, and that person dies. There's 50% estate tax on it. But let's say, for example, you lived in Switzerland. If you had a Swiss company, and that Swiss company bought that German property, and everybody who lived in Switzerland owned the company, if somebody who lives in Switzerland dies, the only thing they're passing on is shares in a Swiss company that Germany has no right to tax.
So we should open up a company and run
a property. I mean, so I'm just saying that this is what I'm talking about with the cross-border estate planning, is you really need to look at where the people are citizens of, where the assets are located, where they're planning going, because there's a lot of little tricks that can be done that can save a ton of money.
Right.
Yeah.
Where does trust come into it? Because I know in the U.S. it's really big to do trust
yep.
to help solve the taxation issues, but they're not recognized outside.
So trusts don't actually solve taxation issues in the U.S. What trusts do is they solve probate issues. So normally what happens is, If you do a will, right, and you say, okay, in my will, I'm leaving everything to my kids. What would happen is if you died, the will has to have an executor. So somebody's going to make sure that the will, that the wishes set forth in the will are actually carried out. And that has to be opened up with a court, and then the judge reassigns the titles and the assets to the various people. And normally, this is done, the executor is a lawyer, and they charge like, I don't know, 6% or 5% or something of the value of the estate for making sure it goes through probate. So in order to avoid these expenses and the complication of having to go through court, a lot of people use trusts. Because the situation is, if you have something in your name and you die and you leave it to your kids in a will, somehow it's got to get from your name to their name. And that takes the judge to do a court order saying put it in their name. But with trusts, you form a trust, and then the asset goes in the name of the trust. So it's not in your name anymore, it's in the trust's name. And so if you die, the trustee of the trust has the right to just go put it in these other people's names. And so you avoid that whole probate process. And so it's not so much of a tax thing as it is an estate planning tool. Trusts are under the Hague Convention, trusts must be recognized in most European countries. Now, they won't recognize them as entities for tax purposes, but they'll recognize the effect that they have on transferring assets.
Okay.
That being said, because Europe is mostly a civil law, or mostly civil law countries, other than like the UK. The US is a common law country. And so trusts are a common law concept, and so the Europeans generally don't know what to do with them. So a lot of times what we suggest is you kind of have to, the way you normally have to do it, you need somebody who's capable of doing US estate planning, that has a decent knowledge of how other countries' estate tax systems work, and then you need the same thing in, let's say, Germany, and a German estate tax person that has a general idea of how the US's work. And those two people need to work together to find a happy medium. And normally, it's a combination of trusts, wills, companies, whose citizenship, you know, depending on the spouse's citizenships, how the property should be titled, all of that good stuff. But it definitely is a tedious exercise to get it done, but well worth the money, because the estate taxes are high. I mean, in Germany, I think it's 50% of the people that receive it. In the U.S., if you go above that 11.2 million, it's 40%.
But if they're still alive when they're transferred to the heirs, then you don't, because my husband
Yeah, I think, I know, and I'm not a German tax expert. I think that there's a certain amount that you can gift under German law that's tax-free. And then I think there's another amount that can be gifted at a reduced rate or something. I'm not positive.
I don't know either. I just know that my kids will have all this property at some point.
Yeah.
Yes. I don't know the details, but I heard that there's recent EU legislation that for dual nationals that you can declare which country, under which country's inheritance laws you would like your estate to be.
Yes, that's true, but it's not so much of a tax law as it is like an estate planning law. So, for example, they passed a law that, like, let's say you're a German citizen, but you live in France. You could choose to have your estate administered pursuant to the laws of Germany. So, for example, this kind of happens when... So there might be certain things that are allowable in a German will that would not be allowable in, let's say, a French will. But if you're a German citizen, you can say, I want to choose my estate to go according to the German law, and France will have to recognize that even though it's not permitted under French law. So it's kind of like in the US we have, I learned this at law school. It's in the Constitution that basically the states have to recognize things done under the laws of other states. And that's basically the same thing for state tax purposes in Europe. Yes?
A hypothetical. An American citizen married to a European citizen living in France, they have property living here. They have property in Europe. The American dies. Is the French citizen then taxed by the U.S. as the value of the property?
Because U.S. citizens are required to pay U.S. estate tax on their worldwide assets. So if you had a U.S. person that lived in France, even if they weren't married, and they owned property there, and they died, the U.S. would have the right to tax the value of that property. So basically the way the U.S. works is this. When a U.S. citizen dies, you have to put a value, you have to determine the fair market value of everything that that person owned anywhere in the world. If the value of it is less than 11.2 million, there's no taxes that need to be paid in the US. If it is more, then there's a 40% estate tax that would need to be paid. In an instance like that, it's more likely, and I don't know French tax law hardly at all, but I think that, does France have an estate tax?
Oh yeah.
They do?
And it's very complex because it's, there's sort of separate legislation for real estate, movable goods and
immobile. You're right, sure.
So real estate is sacred.
Right, okay.
And also you cannot disinherit your children.
Yeah, okay. Wow, so it's good to be a kid in France.
There's a faith controversy. There was a French pop star, Johnny Halliday, who died.
Okay.
And there's this huge, they're trying to determine whether he was legally domiciled in California or in France.
Oh, yeah.
Because it's a mess. It's a mess. But it's, real estate is very dear to
okay, so the answer would be like in a situation like that, if the assets were worth less than 11.2 million, it would be France that would have the right to tax it.
Taxing
the American, yes.
Portugal.
Yeah. Yes, sorry.
So my husband and I are expecting our first child.
Uh huh. Congratulations.
Thank you. And we're thinking about opening an account.
Okay.
To start saving for college or whatever.
For the child.
Okay. So, does it make more, and I'm American and he's Swiss, does it make sense for it to be, I don't know, under his account, my account, or the child's own account?
Well, I think so.
And is it better to have the child be American, or we wait, or have
So I'm assuming your husband is American or not American?
He's not.
Okay, you're American.
Yes.
And how many years did you live in the U.S. after attaining the age of 18?
Oh, yeah.
More more than five?
All my life, basically.
Okay. So your kid's gonna be American whether it wants to be or not. So U.S. citizenship. So kids, the U.S. is different than some countries in that if you're born to an American outside of the U.S. and you meet certain criteria, which generally is, I think, having lived in the U.S. 5 years or more after attaining age 18, the kid's automatically American.
Sorry, is that born to an American or just born to an American mother? I believe it's born to an American mother.
It's born to an American mother or father.
It's mother or father, I believe.
Yeah,
yeah.
I thought it was parents. It's a father. You have to go to the consulate and the embassy.
No, it's both parents.
I think it's both parents. Yeah, but here's the thing though, and obviously I would never recommend doing anything shady, but if the question of whether or not you want it to be American, it's gonna be American, is whether or not they claim it, right? So you register the birth as a birth of an American child abroad, and you get the passport. Sort of my recommendation is, I've lived all over Europe, I've lived in the Middle East, and one of the things that I've seen a lot of is, a lot of people like to send their kids to the U.S. to go to university, or to attend school, or something like that. And that certainly makes it a lot easier if they have the passport. It also gives them the option to live there and stuff. And under the expatriation rules, they can expatriate up to 18 and a half without any tax consequences. So usually my recommendation is to have them be American and let them make the choice when they turn 18. Because it is a good option to have, right? And you never know what's gonna happen to the world. But I mean, it will obviously subject them to have to comply with the US tax laws up until they expatriate if they ever do. Meaning that, they would have to file F-bars if they were working when they were 16 and earned over the threshold amount for having to file taxes, they would have to file taxes. My opinion is they're gonna be American anyway, right? Like,
but in terms of opening an account, for instance?
I think it's okay to open it in their own name. It just means that an F-bar is gonna have to be filed. It's a little bit extra paperwork, but it's not anything that, causes tax, let's say. I mean, if you have an account with, even if it's 50,000 euros in it or Swiss francs or whatever, I don't know how much you'd be planning on putting in it. I mean, unless that income, the interest income off of it is going to be super substantial, it's not going to put them in a position where they'd have to file a tax return, at least not immediately.
And that's opening an account outside of the U.S. If you open an account inside the U.S. in their name,
that's true. That's true. If you can do an account inside the U.S., the only issue that I've seen with that is, a lot of people, unless they're planning on moving back to the U.S. or maintaining very strong ties with the U.S., prefer to have accounts in the local currencies where they live. And that gets tricky in the U.S. because you can pretty much only get dollar accounts. And so that's one of the issues that I've seen with people not wanting the American account so much, because they rather not have the exchange rate risk, they rather have it in their local currency. But you can't avoid the F-bar that way, for sure.
Okay.